Hello all, I hope you all are doing good and having a good day. Welcome to Mitra's 89th webinar. The topic for today's webinar is Understanding Primitive Reflexes and Its Impact on Child Development. Today's topic is presented by our esteemed professional, Dr. Samraj Johnson. Dr. Samraj Johnson is occupational therapist, sensory integration therapist from USA, and he's professor at Usmania Medical College, founder of KITES INC USA and founder of KITES Child Development Center, Hyderabad, India. Sir, a very warm welcome to you on our forum and looking forward for this topic.
Yeah, hi Saujanya. Thank you so much for that introduction, and good morning and good evening all the parents. And as all of you know that we have started this new series of webinar in terms of the different kinds of evidence-based interventions involved in taking a child forward who has been diagnosed with spectrum. So as we started last time, we were talking about reflex integration therapy, and what is the reflex, and how important it is for overall growth of a child. And we have seen the learning hierarchy and what place a reflex integration holds in learning hierarchy, especially the primitive reflexes, then postural reflexes, motor patterns, perception, language, you know, conceptualization, and higher level of functioning. You know, the learning hierarchy we have seen, and we have seen a relationship between reflex integration and sensory processing and sensory motor development in a child. And we have seen a relationship between reflex integration and challenging behaviors. And we have discussed about, the red flags. The red flags in terms of sensory processing and red flags in terms of behaviors. And probably have spoken a little bit of one or two reflexes. So before actually today going into discussing about how a primitive reflex, if it is not integrated, how it can affect and which all areas, if that particular reflex is not integrated, can impede a child's progress is what we are going to see. So probably I'll give you just 30 seconds of time so that you can just procure a pen and paper so that you can jot down the list of primitive reflexes which I usually evaluate before taking a child for any kind of program. So rather than saying them as primitive reflexes, what I would call them is 30 different reflexive patterns which actually will be there in a child in utero, right from when the child is in the womb and till a span of 1 year, till a span of 1 year. So this, when I say reflexive motor patterns, it includes both primitive reflexes as well as postural reflexes. So I'll just list it out for you so that it becomes easy to go ahead from there on. So the first one is core tendon guard, then Robinson grasp, hand pulling, Babkin palmomental, Babinski reflex, leg cross flexion reflex, ATNR, abdominal reflex, then bonding reflex, foot grasp, Thomas automatic gait, then Bowers crawling, Moro's embrace, fear paralysis, hand supporting, segmental rolling, Lando reflex, flying and landing pattern, grounding reflex, head righting, trunk extension, symmetrical tonic neck reflex, spinal gallant reflex, spinal Perez reflex, tonic labyrinthine reflex, foot tendon guard, spinning, locomotion, balancing, and Pavlov orientation. So I hope I would have given you 30 motor patterns. So usually, I mean, these are the patterns which I usually evaluate in a child prior, you know, taking up the program, prior implementing, prior planning to implement what kind of goals we set for a child. These are very important because if a child has not developed these primitive reflexes in them, it shows a quite a predominant interferes. It interferes predominantly in their complete process of development. And this is all, again, like what we have discussed, this is all evidence-based and research-based interventional strategies, because these neurodevelopmental process which takes place in a child from womb to 1 year of age is very predominant in terms of their overall growth and in terms of their learning new skills as such. So usually there are among this 30, there are few specific reflexes which I emphasize more because they interfere to a greater extent in terms of child's progress. So last time I think we have discussed about fear paralysis reflex, and I think we have discussed about Moro's reflex, and I think these are the two things which we have discussed. So I'll give you maybe around 8 or 9 reflexes, and if these reflexes are not integrated, what are those red flags which indicates you, tells you that these reflexes are not integrated in a child? And it is important for you or your treating therapist to start working from this point of integrating this primitive reflex and then go to the next levels of intervention. So let me come to the third one in that, which is tonic labyrinthine reflex. Usually this reflex, we check it in forward position and in a backward position, and it provides tonic labyrinthine reflex usually provides the means of learning about gravity and mastering head and neck control. So you can understand the importance of this reflex. This establishes a complete vestibular and proprioceptive and balance and coordination in a child, and the relationship between head, neck and body parts is what this reflex teaches a child or trains the child to proceed forward. So this plays a vital role in terms of providing an opportunity to develop balance, proper muscle tone, and developing proprioceptive and vestibular sense. And when this particular reflex interacts with other reflexes and bodily process, this helps to develop coordination, posture, and correct head alignment from infancy to toddler age. That means if this reflex is not really integrated, that means there will be a gross motor delay in the child, because this reflex is all about developing head alignment, about coordination and about posture. So a direct indicator for you here, what you need to really take forward from understanding about this particular reflex is, if your child had gross motor delay and if your child had poor balance or is having poor balance, poor coordination, poor posture, that means this reflex is still not yet integrated, because it is critical for tonic labyrinthine reflex to do its job, because correct alignment of head, correct alignment of your head with the rest of the body is predominantly necessary for visual tracking, for balancing, for auditory processing, and it organizes muscle tone so that it will help a child's ability to remain focused, to pay attention, and to learn new skills. So I hope you are able to understand how important a small tonic labyrinthine reflexes. So if this particular thing is not integrated, the things whatever I have told you, all these areas are predominantly affected. All these areas are primarily affected in the child, and thereby the process, learning process, is not happening the way it should be, or child is not becoming functional enough. Okay, so the possible long-term effects, if this reflex is not integrated, you would find balance and coordination problems. I want parents to really retrospect when I'm saying this. If your child, whatever I'm saying, that has got issues with the possible long-term effects which I'm talking about, if your child is having that, then your attention needs to go in terms of integrating the reflexes first. Okay, so first one is balance and coordination problems. They usually have a shrunken posture, you know, that rounded posture, and they'll be easily fatigued. Muscle tone is too weak, or the muscles are too tight, and they'll have difficulty judging distance, depth, space, and speed, which is all very vital for bilateral coordination, which is all very vital for coordination of bilateral eye movements, you know, so those kind of things. And these children usually develop gravitational insecurity, which is, in other words, fear of heights. And if your child is found to be having W sitting, so that is one, this is one of the indicator for you, like that is one of the reason why many of the therapists will ask, or immediately when we see a child in W position, we tell parents to correct it immediately, because that is an indicator for you that TLR is not yet integrated in the children. And usually these children will have motion sickness, they will have visual, speech, and auditory difficulties, and usually these children tend to look cross-eyed. Another way of understanding whether TLR is still predominant in them. So crossed eye pattern will be there in them, and they'll have very stiff or jerky movements. Usually toe walking is again one of the categorization which goes into unintegrated primitive reflex of TLR. They'll have difficulty in walking up and down stairs, and difficulty in following directions and movement instructions. So these are a little set of long-term effects which a possible unintegrated TLR can have in a child. Now let us see another one, that is asymmetrical tonic neck reflex, which is otherwise called as ATNR, which you usually would have heard about it. ATNR plays a very vital role, and it starts from womb, and it should be ideally integrated by 7 months of time. And this is this is one of the reflex which helps in, it links, rather than saying helps, it links head and neck movements to one-sided movements of the body. It links head and neck movements to one-sided movements of the body. Okay, and if this is this place, again, this plays a very vital role in eye-hand coordination, developing muscle tone, and vestibular sense. Eye-hand coordination, muscle tone, vestibular sense are the three major areas which ATNR will help develop in a child. And the possible long-term effects, if this is not integrated in a child, would be one of the reason for dyslexia is unintegrated primitive ATNR reflex. So dyslexia is one of the primary category which we look into. Then, as I said, when I say dyslexia, it goes without saying that, you know, it is have a child is having reading, listening, handwriting, and spelling difficulties, right? And they'll have poor sense of direction, because, as I said, it aids in vestibular sense, and if it is not developed, they'll be not able to have a directionality, and they usually, these children will have confusion in handedness. That means dominance of usage of which, like, you know, we usually say right-handed dominant or left-handed dominant, and we say ambidextrous, right? That means, like, you know, child still has not developed dominance to handedness. That the reason of that could be unintegrated primitive reflex, and they'll have focus and balance difficulties. They are easily distracted. They'll have poor memory, and poor coordination, and possibly they say that these children will develop obsessive behaviors. When I say obsessive behaviors, many parents keep talking about, child keeps holding something in hands for a longer duration of time, or it's difficult to take the toy out of their hands. As soon as he wakes up, he has to keep on holding on to something. That might keep changing, but the toy might keep changing, but this kind of obsessive behaviors can develop in them if ATNR is still persistent in them. And they are very egocentric kids, and they cannot wait for their reward. In other terms, very impatient children. Impatient. So these are possible long-term effects which you can possibly see if a child is having a unintegrated primitive ATNR reflex. Now see symmetrical tonic neck reflex. This is otherwise called as STNR, which usually is between 6 months to 11 months of age, and this helps child lift and control the head for far distance focusing. Lift and control the head for far distance focusing. That means it prepares the baby in terms of creeping, crawling, and using automatic movements for raising up on all fours. That means, it helps them to automatically come to all fours. That means very important milestones, right? Creeping, crawling, and automatic movements to acquire that all fours position. So major milestones are predominantly depends upon this symmetrical tonic neck reflex and its relationship of the head in terms of focusing on far distances. So let's say if this is not really integrated, the possible long-term efforts if STNR is not integrated would be these children would be fidgeting, they will be screaming, they'll have poor posture and slouching, and they'll develop this ape-like walking or toe walking, and usually any kind of visual perceptual skills or anything pertaining to their ability to do things with vision is grossly impaired in these children. Maybe their ability to remain focused, their ability to track, their ability to use directionality, saccades, all that, whatever we talk in visual perceptual skills are by large affected, which means that there is no visual motor coordination which is taking place, and they'll have this trouble staying on task, and they are always clumsy or messy eaters. Usually, one of the way which you can still understand that symmetrical tonic neck reflex is still persistent, the reason that where you can correlate that is if your child is a messy eater or a clumsy eater, then that gives you one indicator that he's still having this STNR in them. And poor attention and concentration by large is affected, because as I said, they will be having visual disorders which will impact their visual attention and visual memory and visual perceptual skills by in itself. Okay, and the next one is spinal Galen reflex. This is usually between the womb to 9 months. Spinal Galen reflex from womb to 9 months, and this again predominantly helps children develop balance and coordination and helps them to belly crawl and creep. I'll repeat, belly crawl and creep. So if this is likely connected to bladder function also, spinal Galen reflex is connected to bladder control also, and the possible long-term effects, number one bedwetting and hip rotation to one side, poor posture, difficulty sitting still, and their spine might not be aligned, or the curvatures involved in the spine might not be the same how it will be in other children. Usually we call it as a term called a scoliosis. That is one thing which they develop, and these children usually get fatigued, they'll have poor concentration, they'll have poor short-term memory. I'm making a note, short-term memory, poor short-term memory. And usually, if the spinal Galen reflex is not integrated, it can sometimes, it is predominantly associated with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder and irritable bowel syndrome. very important for you to know this. Okay, so Spile and Gallant plays such a vital role, you know. So I hope you are able to understand the importance of this primitive reflexes by large in terms of a complete child development as such. And let us talk about another reflex which is really important, which goes many a times, and probably this will help the speech therapists, and you can talk to your speech therapist about this. And this is called as acoustic stapedial reflex. It is called as acoustic stapedial reflex. And usually, if this is not integrated, children will exhibit hyperactive acoustic stapedial reflex, leading to hypersensitive auditory system. Like, you know, what, in other words, what the all the things what we talk about, you know, auditory hypersensitivity or hyposensitivity in terms of closing ears or hitting ears, or, you know, other things like, you know, hitting their head, hitting their jaw, or hitting their chin, or vocalizing constantly certain sounds, is all because that this acoustic stapedial reflex is still not integrated in them, or it's still not integrated to the higher functions. Thereby, it is having it will affect a child's auditory processing by large. That means there is no auditory attention. Child might pay attention to what you are saying, or he might get lost in following the instructions, or he may not pay attention at all to it, or their auditory memory is compromised. So they might look to you more like an attention deficit child, but it could be the reason behind that could be this acoustic stapedial reflex not being integrated in them. And other reflexes like rooting, sucking, and palmar, these are the very primitive reflexes, but very important in terms of developing speech, articulation. And if it is not properly developed, that's the reason why many of the children, if your child is having concerns with the dental problems, that could be one of the reason. The reason, one of the reason behind that could be this rooting and sucking reflex is still not yet integrated in them, or still playing a role in their development. And the possible long-term effects of rooting, sucking, and palmar reflexes by large would be speech delays and difficulty in social situations, and they will develop poor manual dexterity skills. In other words, the fine motor skills, the performance with the fingers would not be at the level or age appropriate, and they'll have handwriting difficulties because of poor fine motor skills. They'll have loose ankle. If you really see, maybe your child's feet might not look very stable, but it will be little tilted or imbalanced at the ankle level, which in other words we call it as loose ankles, and they'll have flat feet, or they'll develop walking on sides of the feet, like the feet, the sole of the feet is not completely on the ground, but they'll be walking on sides of the feet. Okay, and they'll usually develop the swallowing problems. Drooling is another one of the concern, and sometimes they develop something called as temporomandibular joint syndrome, and hip rotation or instability will be predominantly there. Hip rotation, if you see your children's hip, might be tilted outward, so that will cause instability in their gait patterns, or it will affect their posture, or it will affect their gait patterns by large. Okay, what I want you to clearly understand, that if these reflexes are not integrated, it will affect their gross motor development, and once the gross motor development is affected, that refined motor patterns are not developed in a child, their play is affected. If the play is affected, that means their cognitive skills and their social skills are impaired. Okay, so probably what I would say, by end of all these long-term efforts, usually they'll have decreased segmentation of trunk, decreased rotational component in any action, and they'll have postural insecurity, decreased ability to develop anti-gravity muscles, and increased mass movement patterns, and increased dependency on environmental stimulation for changes in posture. So by large, all these things are affected in a child, which makes us feel, or a child might appear to us as completely different. So if these primitive reflexes are not integrated, or the postural reflexes are not developed by the time it should be, these are the things which are grossly impaired in our children. Okay, so I hope you got to understand the importance of unintegrated primitive reflexes. Now, coming to the point in the initial when we spoke about it, we spoke about different programs which are in existence in terms of they precisely focus on integrating these reflexes in a child. One is that MNRI program, and another one is that reflex integration or repetition movement therapies. Okay, so MNRI is nothing but, as we discussed, it has been developed by Mazgutova, Mazgutova neuro reflex integration programs, and usually her theory is all about as I stated, probably I would have stated you last time, that she has come up with this term called as reflex integration disorder. And the idea about all which where they focus is all about muscle tone regulation, challenges with postural control, challenges with motor coordination, and challenges with visual and auditory system, and challenges in reflexive pattern development. You know, these are the, this is how it has evolved, this reflex integration disorder, which she has stated in 2011, is evolved basing on these challenges. Those challenges, again, I'll repeat: postural control, motor coordination, visual and auditory system, and reflex pattern development in itself. And when they have conducted her research and her papers or supports, and tells that when they have conducted study on different children, all the children who have been diagnosed with on the spectrum, 83% of the kids are found to be having difficulties in these reflex patterns. And once these reflex patterns are corrected, she has the studies say that they have seen a very great level of progress in child's overall development. And this program offers a system to organize sensory motor and muscle coherence through re-education of non-integrated reflexes. I'm making it as a point, re-education of non-integrated reflexes, which helps the child to rediscover, right? It helps the child to rediscover how they need to use their body, and how they need to make sense of the sensory systems and the movements together to sense it, to move and react. You know, so the idea about MNRI program is all about this. And usually they say that, you know, it develops kinesthetic consciousness in a child and develops postural and motor programming and postural and motor control. By large, when we spoke about sensory integration disorder, sensory processing disorder, or sensory motor sensory-based motor conditions in a child, the sensory-based motor disorder, what we spoke as one of the classification in sensory processing disorder, where we spoke about the postural disorder and praxia, right? In that, there are two things which come: postural disorders and praxia. By large, they are affected. If reflexes are not integrated, child will develop sensory-based motor disorder. And this MNRI program predominantly focuses on getting this unintegrated reflexes to re-educate. The program concentrates on re-educating of non-integrated reflexes and helping a child to rediscover their kinesthetic consciousness, their postural and motor programming, and control, postural and motor control. Okay, so usually they have different kinds of programs in this. They have different kinds of programs basing on the reflexes. After they evaluate these reflexive motor patterns, they create a separate program for that particular kind of primitive reflexes, and taking into consideration the long-term effects which it is causing. So to mention a few for you, they say that neurotactile reflex integration, arch type movement and lifelong reflex integration, and birth and post-birth reflex integration and orofacial reflex integration programs are some of the things, along with proprioceptive and cognitive reflexes and visual and auditory reflex integration. So if you see, they have broken down it into different components like auditory, visual, cognitive, proprioceptive, vestibular, tactile. So they've taken each and every sense into consideration. The reason why they have taken each and every sense into consideration is because each and every unintegrated primitive reflex will have its own impact in terms of the perception, which we have spoken about in learning hierarchy, like primitive reflex, postural reflex, motor patterns, and then comes the perception, right? So if the top three are not in place, that means the perception is not in place. And in perception, it is all about the senses, all our seven senses, which we usually talk about. There, the correlation exists. Like this primitive reflex is not, this primitive reflex is not allowing child to perceive this particular sensation in a way it should be, thereby it is causing certain problems in child's progress. So that's the reason why their programs are about tactile, different programs for different senses, different programs from birth to lifelong. So here comes the tricky point. Many of the parents ask, and probably ask me during this webinars, is what is the right age, right? What is the right age for my child? Will my child overcome all these concerns? Yes, your child will overcome all these concerns if your program or if the problems are identified in the right way in your child. So I always say that it's a myth that, you know, you cannot give or you cannot, child will not benefit after a certain particular age, usually after the neuroplasticity of the brain takes place. The myth is that, you know, it will not be effective, but that is very wrong. That is very wrong. Everything is affected. That's the reason why this particular research, probably if you really go into Moskutova, her research papers and all, you will, that's the basic idea that she has got, they have developed a separate program for themselves from birth to lifelong reflex development, birth to lifelong. So that gives you a clear indicator that you can still work with your child immaterial of the age of the child if you are identifying the problems in the right direction. Okay, so this is all about MNRI for you. And usually, apart from MNRI, the one thing which I usually do, or I usually work with when we work with parents, or when we create a program for the parents, we usually work on rhythmic movement training program. It is nothing but, you know, we classify it into two different things. The first thing is primitive and postural reflexes, and the second thing is to establish rhythmic and developmental movements. First thing is primitive and postural reflex evaluation. Second thing is to develop rhythmic and developmental movement patterns in a child. So we divide it into two different parts. One is an the part one, we call it as innate sensory motor reflex patterns, in which we teach, which we evaluate or teach a set things, like, you know, those set things would be the original stimulus for the reflex pattern, the original motor pattern of the reflex, and then original function of the reflex in infancy, and how to assess for retained and abnormal reflex activity, and how to reorganize various compensatory behaviors which a child develops, and the consequences that may relate to a specific retained reflex pattern. You know, and various motor and tactile interventions to mature and integrate the reflex pattern. So this is the process which we usually look into, the innate process which we usually look into when we talk about sensory motor reflex pattern development. So these are the questions which you need to ask yourself also. The questions: what is the original stimulus? What is the original motor pattern? What are the functions of that reflex? And how to assess whether these retained reflexes are still there? And how to reorganize these motor patterns? And how to intervene it with a different category? So these are the things which you need to ask yourself. And when you look into the 30 motor patterns, okay? And the second one, which the next level what we look into is, we divide this particular reflexes into two different components. And these two components, what we call at our centers is brain and sensory foundation levels, which is usually the first level of assessing a child. In this, the ones which I have listed to you, the tonic labyrinthine reflex, ATNR, STNR, you know, hand reflexes, fear paralysis reflexes, all that reflexes for which I have given you long-term effects is the one which we assess. And the second level of this brain and sensory foundation is all about spinal pares reflex, Landau reflex, amphibian reflex, crossed extensor reflex and parachute reflex, you know, pull to sit reflex. These are certain things, facial oromotor reflexes. So these are certain reflexes which we usually look into the second sensory foundation, sensory brain and sensory foundation level of assessment. Okay. And after we do evaluate this, then the part two comes into your role. That is innate rhythmic and development movement patterns. Innate rhythmic and development of motor patterns. Along with this reflex assessment and integration protocols, we teach specific developmental and rhythmic movements. Those are the innate self-initiated rhythmic movements of infancy that usually provide tactile, vestibular, proprioceptive, rhythmic motor and rhythmic auditory input to a child so that to integrate these unintegrated primitive reflexes. In addition to their calming, maturing, and organizing effects in development, many of these rhythmic movements, you know, involve in weight shifts that are important in developing proper upright posture, balance, and gait in a child. So if you really understand, I hope probably I have given you the way you need to look into this primitive reflexes, postural reflexes, and motor patterns, and how these particular motor patterns can be evaluated. What are these reflexes which you need to evaluate? And once you evaluate that, what are those long-term effects, or which are those areas, sensory areas, which are getting disturbed because of this unintegrated primitive reflexes? After identifying this particular sensory concerns, sensory areas, because of the impact of unintegrated primitive reflexes, you need to evaluate in which functional areas it is affecting the child. And after you evaluate that particular sensory area which is being affected, then comes creating a program in terms of taking the child forward, wherein it is all about how you are establishing this rhythmic and repetitive movement training programs for a child. So it is all about that neurodevelopmental process. It is all about neurodevelopmental process. And believe me, every occupational therapist will have this knowledge about how to evaluate these reflex integration programs and how to evaluate these reflex protocols and the outcomes of it and how to treat it. But many of the times, as parents or as therapists, we lose our focus and we start addressing in terms of the problem, what you see on the floor, but you will not analyze the reason behind that problem. Thereby, the program will not be successful the way it should be. But many of the parents say, I tell them that, you know, when I create a program, we create it on basis of a child development, and definitely we will see a progress in our progress in terms of child's growth. And they question me, Can you guarantee it? Can you write it on a paper? You know, do you mean to say that autism spectrum will be completely gone? These kind of certain questions which will crop up. I would definitely not say that child will be completely out of the spectrum. But what I would definitely say is, if your program is centered around child development in terms of the learning hierarchy, like the way I have mentioned, definitely you will see a lot better progress and child becoming more functional than where he is at this point of time. Immaterial of the age. Okay, because this is all about we when we talk about a child or an adult, it is all about the activity configuration. And when we say when we talk about activity configuration, the integral parts of activity configuration is work, play, leisure, education, and social activities and social participation, right? And if your program is created based on child development, based on the learning hierarchy, based on the proper evaluation to identify the problems and the impact of certain things which are not integrated, or impact of certain sensory motor integrations not in place, you will be really able to make your child functional in all those areas which I have mentioned to you. By large, last statement which I would like to make here is, by providing this kind of strategies or by implementing this kind of strategies, you are providing fuel to the brain's growth. You know, you are providing the fuel which is required for the development of the brain and for processing of the brain at the frontal lobe level, which is in other words at the executive level. You know, otherwise our child is still acting at the brainstem level or is still in that flight, fight, and that mode. Okay, so this provides a fuel to the brain growth and helps in connectivity of the brain and helps in sensory maturity. Okay, so that is how you need to be really looking into it. And in the coming webinar, probably we will by large discuss about the second level of the other kind of intervention which most of the parents keep asking me about, the impact of listening therapies and impact of what is listening therapy as such. We will probably look into it from in the next seminar. And when I say listening therapy, it is all about auditory integration therapy, the listening programs of therapeutic listening, the different words which we use in that. I'll explain you on all those things. So Saujanya, I think I'm good to go.
So yes. Thank you so much. It was a wonderful session, and I really appreciate your approach of understanding the needs of the child, which is very important in any particular therapy that we take. So thank you, sir. Thank you for a valuable session, and thank you for your time and helping so many parents through so many webinars.
No, I mean, I'm sorry for disturbing you. I think you have established a family over here with me. The Mitra Group is an extended family for me, and all those who are in this particular platform, I think we have established a very strong connection with each other. I want to thank you, Saujanya, for creating this kind of platform. And those who would like to get in touch with me, my number is 919-637-9529. 919-637-9529. And those who really want to approach us in Hyderabad, our centers are open. So thank you so much, Saujanya.
Thank you, sir. It's so nice to have you on the Craft platform. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining in today. See you all soon.